engine, porting it to SH4 processors. I also worked on Proteus and other stuffs. So I'm ICNE for Lava, and I've been working on open source for many years now, as I've been working on VLC Media Player, other project around VLC like DVBlast, Pute, obviously, as I'm speaking about Pute today, and NFS Ganesha, if you're looking for a good NFS server in user space, this is one you should consider. And I'm French, so sorry for my accent. Today I will speak about Proteus and an extension that is called Care, which is an extension to Proteus. So first thing, I will speak about Proteus itself. So I guess you know what syscall is. Oh. So Proteus is just a syscall instrumentation engine. What you can do is that you can alter syscall arguments, you can change syscall return values, and you can even change syscall itself. You can say, okay, you will not do open, you will do open at, or any other syscalls. And you can even say, okay, instead of doing one syscall, you will do more than one, which can be useful in some cases. It's based on ptrace, so you don't need any privileges to do that on your own processes. And it works since Linux 2.6.0, which is old enough, I guess, for most use cases. So just, I guess you know how ptrace is working, but if you have an application which is ptraces by proot, when this call is done, it's going into the kernel. It's a ptrace part of the kernel. And instead of being executed directly by the kernel is asking the ptrace server, so proot, what do you have to do with this syscall? If you want to change something, do it. And when it's done, you go back to the kernel. So for instance, I can change the arguments. Instead of etc host, I will open tmp host.local, for instance, just an example. And then it goes inside the kernel. So this call is actually done. And then it return to the ptracer. So the ptracer can change back some arguments, change the return value or anything. And then it goes to the application. So you can transparently change things so that the application thinks it's doing something, but in fact it's doing other things. So with this mechanism, you can do in user space things that are normally only for roots. So for instance, you can do mount dash dash bind. So you can, I will show you afterward. You can mount files or directory somewhere else in the file system. You can do shroot-like things. And you can do binfmtmisc. I will explain if you don't know what is it afterward. And there is a lot of other use cases that I will show you. So it's kind of Professor Xavier for processes. So it's remotely controlling what the process is doing. So just to show you some use cases, I will do a live demo. It's even better than just speaking. You hear me correctly? Yeah. Take your microphone if you want.
Do you know if there's how much overhead is associated with using Proteus, if any at all?
We did some measurements. It really depends on the use case, because there is some optimization you can do with ptrace. And if you're doing a lot of things that are accessing to the file system, like opening files, the overhead is something like 2 times. But if you're just reading file, the open is you have to do something in open, but nothing in when you read the file actually. So it's in this case is something like 2% something. So it really depends on your use case. We can speak about that afterward if you want. Okay, so I will show you some use cases that we can do with Proteus. So as I said, the first thing is we can do mount dash dash bind like in user space. It's better like this. Okay, so you can do mount dash dash bind things in thanks to Proteus. So I will show you that you can mount, for instance, a local password file into etc password, and the program that will be launched under Proteus will think that it's a normal file. So I can show you. So. As you see, the minus B option means please bind this file on this destination. So when the process cat here will access /etc/password, it will actually see your local file, local.password. So if I'm using ID, for instance, or WAMI, you see that I'm not called, my normal ID is this one. I'm not called Ivoire anymore here. I'm not called Ivoire, but someone else. So actually the program tried to access etc password, but in fact is accessing another one, which is my local one. And you can do that with any files. It's not an issue. You can do that obviously with a directory also. So the same option. You bind, I have a tar repository called tar, and I will bind it on /var, I don't know. It's the same. I find out bash. If I'm trying to go to on slash, I see all it's working normally. And if I'm going on var, it's just nothing. This is absolutely not what is supposed to be in /var. This is actually the repository I have in my home, which is my /tar repository. So with this, you can change a lot what a program actually sees of the file system. So you can trick the program to do other things or to act with other the other way that it's supposed to work. So imagine that instead of binding one random repository on another one, we bind a rootfs, for example, a CentOS rootfs, on slash. So my program actually is running on Debian. You can see I'm running TCOS release. So see, I'm on Debian seed. And I downloaded it for openvz.org. They provide some rootfs as tars, and you can use it. So I have a CentOS 7 rootfs. If I use proot and bind this CentOS rootfs on my slash, so every program that will run will use all the libraries, ldlinux.so, everything from the CentOS root directory. So like this, and I load in bash. So everything that is running now is running in the CentOS, as if it's running on a normal CentOS. Only the kernel is not the right one. All the libraries, everything, is from the CentOS. So etc OS releases, just to show you. So now I'm on CentOS Linux 7. And I access it directly /etc/OS. And if I look, I think at GCC. Oops. I don't have GCC installed on this one, while obviously I have it on my machine. Now my on my normal machine, I do have GCC, obviously. I need it. So the use case behind that is, if you want to try to compile, for instance, to validate your program on many distros, you have the first option is to use virtual machines, to have a lot of different virtual machines and to compile it on each machine. Or you just download rootfs from openvz.org, for CentOS, Fedora, etc., Debian, Ubuntu, Gentoo, to jump into it thanks to proot, and you do the same, you do make, you compile and you test that is working correctly. Only the kernel will not be the right one, but the rootfs will be the same. And it can find a lot of bugs that way. And as we said, it's really light web, so it's kind of easy to do. I forget one use case. Obviously, as you see, I have an Arch Linux ARM rootfs here. If you go inside. Okay, I've been don't have bash. Kidding. Yeah, I have a bash. And if I'm looking at it, it's an ARM one. EAB5. It's an ARM one. So if I'm trying to jump into this rootfs, obviously it will not work because I will try to use libldlinux.so, which is an ARM one. Everything will be ARM, so I can't do that directly. If thanks to Proot, you can ask Proot to run every program under QEMU ARM, or QEMU SH4 if you have a SH4 rootfs. So this time, like before, I'm running. So which means I want to have to be rooted in this rootfs. And then I will also want, I have a special option, mean QEMU. Okay, so every time an exec CV is done by the by an application, instead of being sent directly to the kernel, Proot will add QEMU ARM static in front. So the application will be launched under QEMU user mode and will be executed normally. It's a bit slow because it's QEMU user mode, so logically it's a bit slow. But everything is it's a bash from for ARM, as you see. And the bash I'm using is an ARM one. I can use stop if it's installed on this one. I can use everything. This is the ARM top, which is running on my machine, seeing my events, seeing my processes, and showing them. So I have now four processors ARM, a kind of ARM one. So yes, just as I said, when you do exec CV, instead of launching GCC, you're launching QEMU R64, if you have a QEMU R64 or the QEMU, and then the GCC. So everything is run under QEMU. This is a user mode. We had some issues. We use that a lot in ST for validation. And we also have some really old kernels. We are still using some Redis 4 machines, so it's 269, I think, really old. If you are trying to use a recent rootfs, like CentOS 7 or Debian Seed, it will not work because the kernel is too old for that. The first message it will receive is that glibc refused to load. So we added a functionalities that allows to change the kernel number. When glibc is launching, it's doing a uname to know the kernel version, and then to decide if it's working or not. So you can, as uname is a syscall among others, you can obviously change the syscall. It's a minus k option, so I can run a really new kernel, which does not exist. So obviously, minus a. I've now a 4.0 is not really interesting because it does not exist, but when we are running on 269, for example, kernel, we say, okay, I want 3.0, and all the missing syscalls will be emulated by Proot. For instance, we have now a lot of open at, fstat at, read at, etc., a lot of syscall at something. And it does not exist in all on older kernel, but we can emulate it. It's not completely it's not atomic, it's not completely safe, but it's working. Thanks to that, we are able to run Debian Seed on a Red Hat 4. VLC is working with this. We have a VLC, really recent VLC, working on a machine that is more than 15 years old. So another use case which is fun, when you have a rootfs, you download it from openvz.org, you enter it, all files belongs to you as a normal user. So normally, if I want to install a package inside, I can do it. It will work because everything is belongs to me. But if you launch apt or yum or any other programs like that, they will say, no, you can't. You have to be root to do that. But in fact, you don't. You don't need to be root. So we added a minus zero option. We just fake the recent value of some syscall, like what is my ID? It's zero. Okay, apt is working now. We don't have to do anything more. It's working. For yum also, it's working. We just have to change the return value of ch own, ch group, etc., because they want to change it to root, which is obviously not working. So we say, yeah, it's working. And actually, you can install program and it will work behind that. After that, can show you some, maybe can show you it. So if I'm going in the CentOS one, launching bash, I will yum update. And the first thing will be, you can't do it. Oh, sorry, it's in French, but it's written that you have to be root to launch it. Look, if I rerun it with the minus zero option, you see that it's actually working. It's downloading the new packages, and it will install everything. Everything will work. We are able to install on all the machine, rootfs. It's working. We have yum working. We have apt working. You can do pacman on Arch Linux. It's all is work. Everything is working.
How does this work with the Bionic C library for let's say Android?
For Android, Bionic C is a kind of a problem. But we are able to run it with a modified version of Proot. Actually, so you can do Proot to jump into an Android rootfs. It's working. You need a specific Proot for that, which is not upstream yet. But the contrary is possible. There is a project on Android Play Store that uses Proot to install Debian on an Android device. And you can run everything you want inside this device.
What about device nodes? Can you use MUC node and stuff like that? Because that's the stuff that generally restricts bootstrapping and that sort of thing. So you actually create new device nodes inside the root.
MK node, you mean?
Yeah.
No, you're not root. You can't do that. But if you do it with the minus zero option, it will return that everything was done correctly.
Does it actually?
It's not working, obviously.
Right.
But it returns that it's working because if you really use a command line, if you have a program that needs to install, when you install it, you need to do mknode, obviously it won't work because you're not root, but this program will work anyway without that one, in fact. Because a lot of programs, when they install, they ask for many, many privileges that they don't need. The first time we did that, saying, okay, minus zero, you will fake the ID zero, we say, okay, nothing will work after that. In fact, there is one or two programs that are not working with root privileges, but most are working without. This is really funny. Okay, so I can install everything on that, on this machine. And obviously, as I can do the same on this machine, I can have everything. So I will jump in an Arch ARM rootfs. I need QEMU to execute the binaries. And I'm asking to be seen as root because I want to use pacman, which is a package manager on Arch Linux. And you see I'm upgrading an Arch rootfs on my machine, which is x86. And it's running, actually, technically, it's running. It's working. Okay, back to the slides. So as you see, we can do a lot of things. There is other possibilities that I'm not showing here. Can speak a bit after what you want. So now about testing Proot. It's difficult to test Proot because we want to be multi-distros. Because we want to test on CentOS, Fedora, Debian, Ubuntu, Arch Linux, Gentoo, Slackware, etc. We want to test on all of them, these distros. We want to test on multi-Arch, so x86, x64, ARM, Arch Linux, AR64, and SH4. And we want to be able to test on multiple test suites. Because Proot will see all the programs, so it has to work with all programs without changing anything. And it has to be run as root and as a normal user. And as Proot is based on ptrace, we need to run on the kernel, on the right kernel. So you can do root on a rootfs and test it. It's not fair enough. So we are using Lava for that. We use KVM, mainly a lot of KVM. We're using also QEMU system R64 for that, or R64. And we're using also some ST boards. If you want to look at the results, they are available directly on staging and rv7.com. I just want to show you what, how to write a test. I will be speaking about Lava here. I want to write a bit about it. So, who already wrote a Lava test definition? Except the Lava guys. Yeah, one. Okay, when you want to run tests on Lava, you have to write a YAML file. This is the kind of file that you have to write. So you have different parts. So you have metadata, obviously this is metadata, so it's purely informal for you. It's to help other people or yourself, someone suffer, to understand what you're doing. So like this is done, this was written to run on Debian and Ubuntu, just purely informal for you. And you have the install. This is the thing that you want to have on the board before the test is prior to running the test. So for instance, I want to have the sources of Proot installed on the machine before booting it. So if I don't have Git installed, it will still work. The sources will be installed by Lava before running the test. This is a list of things that I want to be installed by the machine itself prior to running the test, because I know that I need getex, readpass, tracts, background, etc. And then I want to run the test. Most of the time you will just give a script, because it's easier to have a script that will do everything, or you can have different lines. This is exactly what will be run. It will be transformed to a script, technically. For instance, in this script, I just do I go into the sources, I take the next branch, I'm compiling and testing. That's all, really simple script. You can do more complicated stuff if you want to. And then the last part is, how do I know if a test is passing or failing? Lava wants to know what's going on, so it's reading the logs and using this regular expression to know for the name of the test and the result of the test. The result has to be pass, skip, or fail. Obviously, your test suite is not writing the result exactly the same way as we want it. So you can say, okay, if my test suite is writing failed in upper case, it means fail for Lava. You can translate for Lava easily. And this, if you want to change this, so I said for Proot, I need to be run as root and a normal user. By default, when you connect to a board, it's as you're connected as root, so you can do everything you want. And if I want to run the same test as a user, I just have to change this part, because everything is common. And I just change it to add a user, change the permission so we can actually read the files, and run the same script, and you're done. Okay? And the second thing that you have to write when you're running a test on Lava, that you define what kind of board you want, what kind of images you want to run on that board, and the list of tests that you want to run. This is, for the moment, a JSON file. It will be changed to be a YAML, so it will be more consistent, but in some months. And what you have to do is, as you see, there is it? Oops. You have different commands, like deploy in our image, Lava test shell, submit results. It's the different actions that Lava will have to do. So the deploy in our image just mean, please take this image, I give you a new a URL to that one, and deploy it on the device and boot it, please. And as Lava need to be able to connect to the board, if you have to connect with a special user, just give it. You have a password, give it. Then you want to run some tests on the device. So you give a list of Git repositories that Lava will fetch, install on the device, and in this Git repository, you just give the YAML file that I showed you just before. And then if you want to submit the results somewhere, you just give the server to use for that. Nothing really difficult if you know if you read the doc and so some examples. Okay, do you have some questions about Proot before I go to care? Yeah, nothing. Okay, so Proot is as I said a framework for manipulating syscalls. So you can do many things with it, And we added a way to have extensions. So you can extend the engine to add functionalities inside it. That's why we created, thanks to this system, an extension which is called CARE, for Comprehensible Archiver for Reproducible Execution. You can find it directly on the website, reproducible.io. So what is CARE about? Just a Pivot extension, as I said. The goal of this extension is just to monitor file system access. I'm saying monitoring, not changing anything. So the application, when an application is doing a syscall, it will be executed on the kernel. CARE is just looking at it. And every time a new file is accessed, like bin bash, libld-linux, not.so, the file will be stored, it will be archived by CARE in a file, in an archive somewhere, without being touched. We have this archive is kind of minimal rootfs. With this rootfs, you have every file that the program needs to be able to run. Everything, absolutely everything, and no more. And then you can use this archive to re-execute the application. Thanks to proot, you can root in this minimal root file system and relaunch the application. Because you have all the files, you have everything you need. It will be in the exact same file system environment, no more, exactly, no more, no less. We are storing the environment variables, so you will have exactly what you need to run. And I insist on that. We are not replaying the syscall. We are just re-executing the application. The application is constrained to this minimal root file system and executed normally. I will do a small demo because it's way more interesting than just speaking. So just to create a CARE archive, it's just you call CARE and your application. So I can do, you can give me the output file directly, so you know how it's called. And I can launch HTOP, for instance, just to show you that we are not replaying anything. So HTOP is working completely normally. Nothing is changed, just a bit slower because CARE is intercepting all the syscalls to archive the files that are accessed. And at the end, you see I have an archive here. I can execute it. It's an auto-extractable archive. So, and if I go inside that one, I have different things. I have proot itself, because we are based on proot. We are reusing proot to execute the application. A readme, if you need to know how it's working. A script that you can call that will re-execute the application in this rootfs with the same environment, the same command line, etc., etc. And you have the rootfs. This is the minimal rootfs that was used, that is needed to rerun the application. If you look at it, I don't have that much things that I need actually to run. This is all the files that are accessed by HTOP when it runs. So you have LDSO cache, local time, password, all the libraries that HTOP needs, libncurse, libm, etc. LDLinux.so, this is the one that will be executed. And yeah, some other things. And if I rerun re-execute.sh, I have the same one. And as you say, I'm not replaying the syscalls. So I actually see what's actually happening on my machine. And this put is the re-execution of HTOP, in fact. And if I take this archive and use it on another machine that does not have HTOP or not the same version, it will work with the same way. So I think I have it here. I will upload it. Sorry. So imagine what you can do with that. You have someone that is saying, I cannot compile this program on my machine, it's not working. Usually what you're doing is, okay, give me the distribution you're using. Okay, Debian seed, I have it, cool. or Fedora. I'm not using Fedora, it's difficult. Okay, what are which package do you have installed on your machine? Okay, you're missing this one, please install it. Blah, 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 blah. And finally, you're finding that you're not using the same version of the libraries, you don't have the same environment, so it's not working the same way, etc. You have a lot of dependencies on the file system that it's difficult to reproduce. Thanks to Pivot, you have everything which is in this care archive, and you can look at it and understand why it's not working, and you can even reproduce it. So if I'm going on my server, execute it, and I can re-execute it the same way. And as you see, I have, for instance, Apache, some things that are running on my servers, MongoDB, Python, etc., etc. So this is really, HTOP is really working on my machine, on the other machines. And this is two different versions of the kernel, not the same, exactly, not exactly the same, on the same environment, etc. And when you launch your execute script, you might want to understand what's going on, so launch other commands. If they are present in the file system, you can't overwrite. Like, I want to know the version. Don't know if it's working with HTOP. Okay, I can have the... I'm executing this command in this minable rootfs. If I run HTOP without care, so outside of this care environment, I see that I don't have the same exactly. Right, it's really close, but... This is in the care archive, this is on my server, which is not the same exactly. So I have another one if you want. Yeah, you can do that with many programs. I have one with VLC also, which is working. The same thing, you can run on Debian Seed and you can run on any other machine the same way. So yeah, just to summarize, sometimes those are failing. It happens. How do I reproduce it? This is maybe even more difficult than fixing the bug sometime. What you need, the same hardware. Yeah, in this case, just ask Linaro, they have some for you. The same software environment and the same environment variables. If you have these three things that are okay, it should work. Yeah. Not always, but it should work. Care will help you for the software part. So just to summarize what you can do with it. So as I said, if you have, for instance, you have a compilation which is failing, you can rerun make with minus G1, because maybe it's a root cause of the problem. You can look at one program at a time, etc., etc. You can really try to reproduce things inside Care. And you can do even with cross architecture. You run Care on an ARM board. You don't have an ARM board, but you have QMUR user mode which is working. Then you can ask, you can try. QMU system user mode is not completely stable, so if you have threads, it will not work. But if it's not ready, it works really well. Do you have any questions? Because I can speak about Care a lot, really long, but it's not really interesting if you don't have questions about it.
Files that are modified during the run. Question. So, if the run modifies the file, you obviously capture the original state, and then you rerun it, and every time you rerun it, you copy the whole thing so you can rerun it again from the same point.
Okay, so when you capture the first execution, Care will archive the file before the modification. And will not archive the modified file. So in the care archive, you have the first version of the file. When you extract it and you execute it, the application will modify the file. So if you rerun it a second time, it's already modified. But this is what happens. You're really reproducing it, technically. So it has to be done that way.
How well does it work with GDB? Like, say, if you wanted to debug the application.
That's a good question. Do you know that ptrace is not redundant? You cannot do ptrace on a program which is already... You cannot ptrace two times a program.
Yeah.
And it's based on proot, which is ptracing. So it should not work. But in fact, Cedric, the guy who did that, implemented a ptrace emulator inside proot. So now it's working. Because a lot of people were asking, yeah, Care is cool, but I want to debug, so I need GDB. So with ptrace emulation, you can do it. So now you can do it. It will work. It took something like 6 months to be written, and maybe 2 or 3 more months to be usable, really usable. But you can pass the GDB test suite, and everything works correctly. Very impressive.
It's better than native, then.
What?
That's better than native.
Other questions? Even on pure or whatever? Then, thanks.